Hey there, it's Joe Johnson, host of Beatle Brunch, and we've got a lot going on, including our brand new redesigned website. So I hope you hop on to brunchradio.com, check it out. You can listen to every Beatle Brunch on demand. You can go back in time with old Brown shows, news, interviews like you're going to see today, and so much more. So thanks for checking this out. Hey there, it's Joe Johnson, host of Beatle Brunch. I am joined on whichever side of the screen you're looking at by my good friend Mark. I'm going to introduce him in a second. He is the lead singer and the bass player for the Grassroots. We met on the 2016 Flower Power Cruise. Oh, I remember. Look at that. He's shining a light. I'm going to shine a light on him for you in just a minute. Anyway, he just had a single out, which was fantastic, called Let Me Comfort You. It came out in March, and it's really about what people are going through during the pandemic and the lockdown and the stress of whether or not you're going to get the vaccine, the whole thing. It was a brilliant song, and he's a brilliant artist. He was started out in the Street Kids. I heard about those guys. They're legendary back in Chicago. So let me welcome Mark Dawson before I get carried away. MarkDawson.us if you want to keep up with us.
Thanks, Joe. How are you doing, man? Good to see you again. Always good to see you.
Well, you know, it's funny because I feel like I see you all the time because I see you on the pop-up concerts. I see you on Facebook all the time. You are one of the musicians who's really mastered social media. You know, so many of them will be like, you know, I can't do that social stuff or media stuff, you know. But you're good at it, man. You really engage everybody. Although you got kicked off of Facebook.
Actually, if you want to know the truth, I've been kicked off 3 times. The first time I was given no reason at all.
Right.
Second time I referred to a former friend of mine as an idiot, and that got me banned for 3 days. And then recently I was shocked. It said I was banned for 7 days, and then it says review your case. And I went back and looked at it. I called a group of people, and I'm sorry if anybody disagrees with this. There were a group of people at the state capitol in Tennessee protesting having vaccines for Americans. And I said, you bunch of turkeys ought to get it together and get your vaccine. Those were my words exactly. Right. That got me 7-day suspension.
Wow. Did you get food or water or anything the whole time?
It's mostly just bread and a steady. I got to look at Instagram all I wanted, but I couldn't hang out on Facebook.
Oh, that is crazy. So how did you know? How did you know when you were going to be able to get back on? You just knew it had been a week, right?
They remind you. Oh yeah, they remind you. They keep putting the same thing. You violated this policy, and then they put it again. Each time it said, "You people are a bunch of turkeys. You ought to get it together." It's like, wow. Nice call. And every time I look at it, I went, "Yeah." So I called them turkeys. What's wrong there? You know, I didn't belittle anyone. I guess if you, it doesn't matter.
I don't know if the statute of days from Thanksgiving had passed. Maybe it has to be so many days within 15 before or after. Either way, I don't know.
You know, it could, but they got me. Okay, so you win, Tennessee. You win. Don't get your vaccines. It's okay. You're not turkeys. You're
not
good
coming on anything that Mark and I are going to be involved in. So, but first, let me ask you. I've been following what you've been doing. And the Grassroots have done some shows. I've seen you guys have done some socially distant concerts. Have you done? You've done a few of those, right?
Somewhere. Oh, you know what? I did a show up as a special guest on the group, the Cherry Drops. My friend Vern Schenk and his band, Josh Cobb, great producer, great guitar player. They were doing a really well socially distanced show in Flagler Beach, about an hour and a half away from where I live. And they asked me if I, Steve Boone from the Loving Spoonful.
Yeah, yeah, he
was
lives
also
down in Fort Lauderdale. Yeah, right.
Yeah, Steve actually has moved up to, now he's in St. Augustine. He's a boating guy. He just gets in his boat and goes, you know, shore to shore. So Steve was there and they said, would you come out and do a thing also? And so I did a couple songs with them. That's the only real thing I've done. And it was done well. I have to applaud the people in Flagler. Really did it well. So it was an 1,100 seat auditorium, and there were about 170 people total.
Wow.
Just little dots all over the place when you look out at the crowd.
Well, that's kind of cool that you were able to do that. So, but what I think is really amazing that you have done, and whenever we're recording this, it's going to be more by the time people see this, but you have done in a row 360 or so daily concerts on your Facebook page. I guess even though you were kicked off for that week, you still went on, and I heard you still went on and did the show. No, you actually opened. You were under it. You were guesting on somebody else's Facebook.
Yes, Mrs. Noise, my wife.
I did see that one. Right, right. So you've done these pop-ups, and tell me about them.
So when it started, it's actually 369 days yesterday. So we're 370 days now.
Wow, crazy.
It started because the lockdown. I released a song called "In Isolation" on April 20th last year. So it's been out 1 year, and from that song, the song is about the pandemic and how different, you know, how it feels, how we're going through it. I was trying to make it hopeful. Anyway, that by debuting that on the air just a few days before it was released, I started, people seemed to enjoy it so much. And I could tell immediately people needed some, they were worried, you know, we didn't know what was going to happen. And so I thought, you know what? I'm not going anywhere. I'm not playing any music. Why don't I just go on? And it's in a private group. It's a fan group.
Okay.
So it's called Making Noise with Mark Dawson, Fans and Friends. That's the name of the group.
Okay, yeah.
So there's about 600 people that in this group, and we'd love to have you join too. If anybody wants to join, come on over, you know?
Yeah.
So I could tell that people were worried and didn't know what was going to happen, how we're going to move forward. And I thought a little music is always good therapy. And so I just one day said, hey, you know, came on unannounced, just started playing a few songs. And that sort of snowballed into, can you do it again the next day? Could you do it again? And more people started to, I would pop in at just generally any time and do it. Now I do it about 5 o'clock Eastern every day because it's just easier for people. That's how it began. Just, I was trying to give a little, a little comfort maybe to a world that we didn't know what was going to happen.
Right. So, and you did something recently too, where people could request a song, you would record it, and you would send them the vinyl. Is that right?
Yeah, that was, boy, this is something unique, I'll tell you, Joe. And I'm going to do it again. It was that successful.
Because I've seen people on Facebook say, Mark, I got my vinyl today, you know?
It's funny. I thought I actually bought one for myself, and I thought it was here, but it's not. A company out of Brooklyn, New York called Least of All. Like, that's the least of all you could have said. They kind of truncate the word, and it's cute. They got a hold of some 1950s lathe cutting record. When they used to cut 45s with a diamond needle, each one was cut separately. So they got a hold of some gear from the old days, had it refurbished completely. And then what they do is they take your one-of-a-kind. They actually do sessions in their studio as well. You and I could walk in and just play something and it goes right to a record. Right. So these records are clear vinyl and it runs at 33 and a third, but they're about the size of a 45. And I wasn't sure how it was going to go. Well, they told me I had the second most sales they've ever had from any project.
The second least of all.
It's like, I want to be number one. I don't want to be
most of all. We're going to change the name to most of all.
Most of all. And so, but the thing about, I made five of my songs available and then they could choose from the five. I did different versions of those songs with a special message at the beginning of each record. So if you had a record, I say, hey, Joe, this is Mark. I really appreciate your support, you know, or, you know, something that you and I would have in common. And then I'd say, so, hey, enjoy listening to the ukulele song. And then the record starts. So it was really unique in that way that every single record, there's only one of it. And when I did this the last time, I had no idea. I put in about 2.5 weeks of work, 5 hours a day doing this, just these tracks. I thought, what did I get into? But it was so much fun. And the folks seem to enjoy it so much. And I'm already getting people say, when are you doing it again? I want more vinyl.
Now, can I request In a Gotta Davide? I want to get my money's worth.
The records cannot be over 5 minutes and 30 seconds. That's one of them. So I can't do that one, Joe. Sorry.
Oh, man. Okay. You don't do like, remember they used to, American Pie would finish on the back?
Or 8-track tapes, they would just fade quickly. You hear a click and then they start up again.
They start. Well, I used to know, like I had the Hotel California 8-track and I knew when they sang hit it with your steely knives, then I could switch to four and I would catch the beginning of the song I really liked on the album. I can't remember, but I just remember steely knives. I go, click, click, click. Okay, track four.
So you didn't wait for, but they just can't kill the beast?
No, because then I'd miss the intro of the song I really wanted to hear. And you got to wait for the whole thing to come around again.
Oh, man, our life was rough back in the 70s, wasn't it?
Yeah. Hey, wait, stay right here. Hang on.
I'm not going anywhere. There's a man with a jacket.
They were out of camera view. I have my Magical Mystery Tour.
You have an 8-track. Holy cow.
Okay, hang on. I've got Beatles at the Hollywood Bowl 8-track. When I got rid of all my 8-tracks, I just kept the ones that I really loved. And I got two George Carlin 8-tracks, which I don't think I can play for anybody, or I'll get
probably, yeah. No.
But brilliant guy. But anyway, yeah, I kept those.
Question is, do you have an 8-track player and does it work?
I don't have one. But I watch these car auctions all the time in Kissimmee and everywhere else. And sometimes they'll show like a 71, you know, Monte Carlo or something with an 8-track in it. So maybe I got to buy the whole car. I don't know. That seems like a little pricey thing. Mrs. Coop would not be happy about that.
Coop, I think she'd understand. I know her. She's a smart lady.
Yes, she is. And I'll make sure I play this for her. So so let's get over to you. What are you doing now? You're so busy with the daily concerts and the radio shows live on Thursday and then another one on Saturday. And I mean, how do you have time when the world finally goes back? What are you going to do?
Well, the interesting thing about that is I know, at least on my calendar, I know exactly now when the world is going back. I know when work will start up again.
Okay.
And as long as that doesn't change again. So I've never wanted to kind of sit idly. I don't really like that much. Right. Once I found out, okay, this we're going to start, we work in July and then it stays steady. As long as everything goes well, starting on July 2nd, my schedule is pretty much back to normal.
Okay.
I thought, I've got all these things going on. I mean, I've got nothing going on, is what I meant to say. So I started creating things. The first one was writing the new songs last year and then starting up the video. That led into a CD, which was All My Best, which was called All My Best, which then led to doing live concerts, including a pajama party live at Mark's house. And from there, we went on to the vinyl thing. And I'm now in the process of another CD project, which I should have. It's in production already. That should be available. I'm thinking about the 8th, maybe 10th of May. So that's my last big project, although I am doing one. There is one more. I'm filming for Florida hospitals. I wrote a song for them that I'm filming at the end of May. June is wide open. And then, so I have planned it. I know that in July, I'm back to work.
Well, get your beaching in and all your fun stuff with Mrs. Noyes. You've only had a year and a half to practice it, but get it all in before July.
We'll probably hit the beach again. She's a big fan of the beach. And, you know, they say the happy wife, happy life, you know. So I love the beach too, Joe.
I think you should do a song, Happy Wife, Happy Life.
If you want to be happy for the rest of your life.
Never make it. Oh, I'm not going to say that.
That's why I stopped.
I hear you. We know when to shut it down.
And you and I both cannot, we can't understand that. We have beautiful wives.
Yeah. Beautiful and supportive and so much fun and all that good stuff. So
Jimmy Soul was just probably a rough guy. He couldn't find the right girl.
He liked a good meal, bro. The guy liked a boy. She cook. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So love that stuff. So, you know, I invited you to be on Beatle Brunch because I want to ask you about, we were able to defer when our taxes are due. So it's May 17th. Yeah.
April 15th.
Right. Yeah. So knowing that you have a strong connection to not wanting to part with your tax money, but you do, you put together a special recording and I'm so honored that I'm going to get to play it on Beatle Brunch. Can you tell us about it?
Well, when we talked a while back and you mentioned you were doing was it 55th year anniversary or something?
We were talking about Revolver. So that, the anniversary of Revolver.
Right. That's right. Our conversation was Revolver. And I started listening to that. I actually right away put it on. I mean, that record is incredible. There's just so, and I think people forget because they go right to Sgt. Pepper. Yeah. I started thinking, wait a minute, Eleanor Rigby, Yellow Submarine, and your bird can sing. I mean, it's just
everywhere. Yeah.
Every song. And then I was, cause I had right before you and I had that conversation, I was talking to a friend about how George Harrison's songwriting really began to develop once he hit Taxman. That just, George just really got that. He hit his stride right there. And we were talking about what a great rocking song that is. And and then you and I talked, I thought, oh, Taxman, can I record Taxman? I was just excited about the song. And I do love this song. I'd love the words to it. I love the chord structure to it. I didn't want to change anything on that one. Just, I think I changed the guitar solo a little bit, but.
I think on that song, it's interesting. I think Paul plays lead guitar on the original.
Right.
George plays rhythm. And because people, I've got an interview with you. Oh, I love your guitar on Taxman. He goes, oh, that was Paul, you know.
I know. Did you ever, I think it's in Jeff Emmerich's book, the one called, that was not a good moment in the studio with Paul picking up the guitar. I guess George Martin is the one who said, hey, Paul, why don't you give it a go? Wow. Paul picked up the guitar, did it in one take.
Ooh.
George had been struggling to get something that really stood out.
Yeah.
And George Martin kept saying, no, again, try something else. And Paul walked in and did it. And then I think he just put the guitar down and says, all right, then we'll see you later. And just to kind of rub it in a little bit there.
You know what, though? I think they all did that at one time or another. I know there's the famous story of John being so fatigued with Obladi Oblada that it was like this waltzy kind of a calypso or reggae thing. And he was a little out of his mind one day, and he was so tired of doing that song, he came in and he goes, okay, here's how it goes. And that's what they ended up using.
So. Oh, gosh. That song is, that's not one of my top favorite songs, but it's fun. It's got its merit,
it
I guess.
It has this whimsy to it.
It does.
So Taxman, is that, for now, it's electronically available from markdawson.us. I don't know if you have it up on your website, but we're going to play it on Beatle Brunch. And, you know, you stayed really true to the original, like you mentioned, but what were you thinking about when you were about to record it or while you were singing it?
Well, I wanted to be sure. I knew there were little nuances in the background of the song.
Mr. Wilson.
Turns out, I guess he's not saying aha after all. I think he's saying tax man, Mr. Wilson, tax and right. Mr. But I thought it was aha. Now, I don't know how tax and ah sound the same, but to me they did.
Right.
So if you listen, I think I went, aha, Mr. Wilson.
I like it though. I think they would have chosen one of those if they had you in the studio with them.
So I wanted to be sure I got those little things. And most important, at least I think in that song, the most important thing, and not because I'm a bass player, the part that Paul played on bass is so driving in that song. And he never relinquishes that drive when he gets to the chorus or when he gets to the solo. That bass is pushing the whole song. So I had to pull out my Beatles bass for that to make sure I wanted to get the Paul tone. But I really wanted to make sure I drove the song with that.
You have a Hofner?
I do. It's on the wall somewhere. Oh, I see it. Yes.
Okay. I trust you.
I had to look around the room. Yeah, I got one on the wall over there.
Nice. Nice going on. So what other instruments do you play? I know that obviously, by the song, you probably play a bit of drums or...
I could name 20 other instruments, but I would never name drums. Here's the strangest thing about that is I could, and I'm not trying to build myself up, but as a percussionist, if I were playing conga or timbale or any sort of percussive, I am in the groove. I feel good. I know I got it. You sit me down behind a kit, I am like a guy with one arm and no legs. I can't pull it together. So, I mean, I can't keep a beat, which you know, drum machines and loops and everything else, that's what I use. So any drums you hear, I create the parts, but I'm doing it with loops and things, electronic stuff. I can hold drumsticks. I'm really good at holding
them. And you know, like, but if when you it goes to like an auto race or something, you could probably
Man, they would hire me in a heartbeat. They go, get that guy, he can fling the sticks. But when it comes to actually playing, and No, not
Does
even
that come
possible.
From your years working at Benihana?
Everything's in the air.
Except when it's in your pocket. Oh, look at that.
Do they take shrimp out of the pocket there?
Yeah, they do. They throw it up in the air and they catch it in their hat or in their pocket. You see, I've been to a couple of family dinners. We'll meet at the Benihana. What are you going to
do? Which one are you married to, Benny or Hana? Which one?
Wow, that's a good question. Depends upon the day of the Japanese calendar.
There you go. Oh, gosh. They are so fun, though.
You're going back on in July. Are you back with you're going back with the Grassroots? You guys are going to be out starting at that point?
Yeah, we've got a full schedule of stuff that starts July 2nd, a date in Florida, and then we go on to New Jersey and all the regular places, a lot of casinos, performing arts centers, those sorts of things.
So are all four of the band members coming back with an extra COVID-19 pounds?
I know
you've been good. I watch your salads on Facebook, so you've been eating pretty healthy.
I've actually lost 3 pounds in the last year. I weighed myself the other day. I said, for the first time since forever, I'm actually under 200. I'm at 198, if you can imagine that.
Wow, that's fantastic.
Yeah, I don't know how. I've been eating the same. It's just, I guess you get old and then I don't know.
Well, maybe you're not going out for as many dinners where you can't really control what's in the calorie count over there, you know?
I will say I have, with the exception of maybe Sundays, I've cooked every single day. We're vegan. Well, we lean vegan. I do like cheese. Sorry.
Yeah. Doesn't have eyes.
There's no eyes in the cheese, right? Cheese didn't have a mom either.
No, that's right.
Anyway, I have cooked every single day since this lockdown began in March. Of 2020. I love it. I love cooking. So it's been fun to do. And Mrs. Noyes, she may have got some COVID weight on her.
Oh, but I'm definitely editing this out.
I'm kidding.
She looks fantastic. And you guys just had what, a 36th anniversary?
34th anniversary.
34th.
Yeah. Wow. We were married in 87. We got married. We lived in sin for about 9 years prior to that. So we were well versed in all those sinning type things before the marriage.
Gotcha.
So
okay. Well, congratulations on your anniversary.
Thank you.
And what's your go-to song right now when you're just in the car? I know sometimes I'll hear from you and you're in the car and you're listening. Is there a go-to artist or a go-to song? Doesn't have to be Beatles, but what have you been leaning to these days?
I actually have two. My favorite, my absolute favorite new artist. He's not all that new, but his name is Alan Stone.
Okay.
And Alan's out of the Portland area. He's probably been 10 or 12 years he's been around. Easiest way to sum him up. He is the white Stevie Wonder. Amazing, soulful vocalist. A tremendous amount of personality in his songs, plus when he's just talking, or he's the friendliest, funniest guy you ever want to meet. I absolutely could listen to Alan Stone nonstop. The other one would be the Dunwells. There are a couple of British guys who again, they've also been around since about 2008. Just a duo, the best songwriters I've ever heard. And they're known a little bit. They come to the United States once in a while, and they've actually played at my house before. They've actually, the last time, that 2 years ago, they were at South by Southwest, and they had a day off, and they were coming to this area, and I know them, and I said, I could set some people up and get you a house concert at my house. They made about $1,000 walking out of
here.
Oh,
wow. Very nice of you to put that together.
My friend. Oh, my friends were so generous, but they're so good. They're amazing. I can't wait for them to come back. I told them I want to produce their next album. I would love to do that. They're just they sing and they write and they've got all these parts and you go, that's so fresh and different and new. Yeah. They're like Crosby, Stills and Nash. Take away Nash. Oh, but their vocals are still great though.
Yeah.
Nash has that high vocal there. Anyway, that's my people, Alan Stone and the Dunwells. That's my go-tos.
I'm going to check them out, the Dunwells. I've been listening to, I got the new Barry Gibb CD where he does all the duets with all the different people.
Yeah,
it's really good. And not to free plug here, but when you get it at Target, you get two extra tracks. So that's, and it's like $10. It's a great bargain. So I like that a lot. I like the one he does with, Olivia Newton-John, because it's just sentimental that, you know, she's been through so much, and they do a song together. Pretty great.
Anytime you can hear Barry Gibb, that's not a bad thing.
Yeah. And then I'm just about done listening to the Peter Frampton audio CDs of his biography. It's really excellent. You would like it. It's 99% of it is about guitars. He's talking about what he played, and you know the story that he lost his Gibson in a plane crash, and it 35 years later he got it back. Some kid had it in Curacao or somewhere.
I had heard about that. He got that. Then I'm gonna have to read that then, because
I just like, because I have such a long commute in the morning and back. I've been popping the CDs in and listening to the audio version, because you know he veers off script every once in a while, and when he's reading, he'll go, "Oh, that was so much fun," you know, whatever. It seems like, you know, you kind of get to know him when you're riding around.
Barry Gibb seems like a nice fella.
Yes. And Barry Gibb lives in on Miami Beach, and I've never, you know, I've probably driven by his street a million times, but I've never had a chance to meet him, but he's a local guy, Miami.
Well, you said your commute was long to work.
Oh yeah.
My
commute is from here to Miami.
I think it's like 3 miles, but it takes you 45 minutes, right?
You're looking for a parking spot at 5 a.m. The whole town is shut, still locked, you know? No.
So. Oh man, the last time I was in Miami, I don't know, 6-7 years ago, and we drove around looking for a parking spot. We found one with no problem for $45.
Yeah.
It was no problem at all.
Coop and I actually went home. We drove to Hollywood Beach on a Labor Day to have lunch. This is a couple of years ago, and we couldn't find a parking spot, and the restaurant had it, but the parking spot was $30 or $35. I go, I'm probably not even going to spend that on lunch. So we left. We went home. It was just insane. You couldn't park. Yeah.
It's crazy. So, you would think if it was their lot, they might actually say, yeah, you can eat it. Come on. Yeah,
exactly.
Two drink minimum.
I want to play TAXMAN, but I want to have you set it up. So tell everybody who you are, where they can find your music, how they can learn more about you. And any way that you want to set up TAXMAN on Beatle Brunch, I would be honored, my brother.
Here's my take on one of my favorite cuts off the Beatles Revolver record. This is when George Harrison hit his musical stride as far as a songwriter, and maybe as a singer as well. This is my version of TAXMAN coming to you right now on the Beatle Brunch.
God, always a pleasure, man. It's too bad they cut me off after a half hour here on the Zoom, but I'll get the paid version and call you back one of these days. They can find you at markdawson.us. Download your songs, listen to them, enjoy the concert on the Facebook page. What is the link for that?
Our private group is Making Noise with Mark Dawson, Fans and Friends.
Awesome.
And then you go ahead and click that, and all you have to do is answer one question. You'll have to say, what band is Mark the lead singer of?
Oh,
it's the Grassroots.
All right, man, it's always a great pleasure. Stay safe, and I hope to see you in the flesh when we cross paths
soon enough. I know that we'll get out there. There'll be cruises soon.
Yeah.
There should be festivals everywhere, so I look forward to seeing you. I always see you on some cruise or some festival. It's always good
somewhere.
To see you.
Yeah, we're good to see you too, bro. All right, man. The best to Mrs. Noise, and be safe. And thanks for being on the Beatle Brunch Zoom.
My pleasure, Joe. Thank you. Say hi to Coop for me, will you?
I sure will, bro. Take care.
Take care, my friend. Bye now. Let me tell you how it will be. One for you, 19 for me. 'Cause I'm the tax man. Yeah, I'm the tax man. Should 5% appear too small? Be thankful I don't take it all. more. Taxman, Mr. Heath, 'cause I'm the taxman. Taxman, 'cause I'm the taxman.